Okay, so thank you very much, Kenneth, for the quick introduction and for doing this webinar again for everybody due to the initial technical errors that we had for the recording session. Now, this afternoon, what we are going to share with you is regarding the optimizing your machine utilization level, right? And how do we keep our machines running at optimal level using machine health monitoring methods? Right, and these are methods that will actually help to keep your machines running at optimum level, right, and also help you to identify where are the root cause of the machine with regards to, it's running for a long period of time, there are wear and tear and so on. And this will actually help to actually, solve certain issues with regards to your machine so that you can keep them running at optimum level over time, right? So let's go to the first slide. Now, the first part, we'll talk about data-driven strategy towards manufacturing cost optimization. And then we'll move on towards looking at machine health monitoring methods for optimum equipment effectiveness. And the last part of it, we will actually talk about machine health monitoring strategies, which we can actually use to actually obtain data. And that data can be actually used to gather insights about your machine and, run predictive analytics and eventually will help you to optimize your machine utilization. Now, the first part about Industry 4.0, as we all know about it, and we all see the stages of the industrial revolution, right? So Industry 4.0 for us is a journey, right? And there are many stages in the Industry 4.0 development path. So the first part of it is, of course, talking about digitalization, where we talk about computerization and connectivity. Now, when you computerize and you connect different devices, different machines, that's where you obtain a good form of infrastructure for digitalization. Now, the next part of it is then how would digitalization benefit an industry, right? Through an Industry 4.0 methodology. So the next part of it is actually how data, right, can be used to actually provide visibility. Right, and visibility here talks about what is actually happening, right? Therefore, you are able to see in real time what is actually happening to your machine operations and so on. Then you talk about why is it happening, right? Once you obtain a lot of data, you are able to see the data happening in real time. Then you are actually able to understand what is actually happening and why is it happening. Therefore, obtaining transparency. Now, once you have visibility and transparency, so the next step is, having the ability of being prepared, utilizing those data, therefore identifying what will happen, right? Therefore being prepared with predictive capacity. And once you have more predictive capacity, you are able to then adapt, right? You have adaptability. Hence, you can utilize this data, this information, and that predictive capability to do your own optimization, right? And you know what would potentially happen. You are able to forecast what will potentially happen, and therefore take the right steps and methodology to mitigate them, right? So the whole idea about Industry 4.0 is actually realizing how data can actually create value for you, right? And how does data create value, right? For an industry or for a manufacturing industry, you utilize data to actually reduce your overall time delay. So we talk about time delays where, you have something that happened to the machine, right? Let's say something happened, therefore your machine break down. How long does it take for you to know when your machine breaks down? Is it the next half an hour or is it almost instantaneously? Therefore, a single insight delay, right? The time for you knowing that your machine breaks down is a time delay for you. Now, the next part of it is analysis, right? To look at your machine when it breaks down, you want to analyze what is the root cause. How long do you take to analyze? How long do you take to make decision? And how long do you take to take an action? Right, so all these time delays, if we are able to minimize them, all right, or to reduce these time delays or even mitigate them, therefore, overall, you actually can reduce a lot of costs. Because in every day of a manufacturing industry, right, every day, the only constant that you have is time, right? So every one of us have 24 hours in a day. Your shift time is also fixed already. So therefore, the only way to optimize your costs is actually to maximize your potential and productivity during the time that you have, right? So talking about machine health monitoring, how does it actually benefit the industry over time? Now, if you look at this graph of a P to F curve, P to F curve here says that your potential failure to functional failure curve, right? So every equipment that you purchase, there will be a time where your machine will reach its functional failure. right? So if you look at this curve, when you first buy a machine, your machine should be working at optimum level, right? It should be working at optimum level. Therefore, you know that when you buy a machine, it's brand new, it will always work at optimum level. Now, over time, then, you know, it starts to degrade. Well, because due to wear and tear or due to its lifespan, it starts to degrade because every part of the machine has its own life expectancy, right? Similar to a car, right? When you drive a car, there's a mileage meter, and every 10,000 kilometers, you have to send your car for servicing or to change certain parts. Now, machines are the same, right? Over time, it will slowly degrade or wear and tear, and until a point, it reaches functional failure. Now, what are the sort of symptoms that the machine will provide, right? So let's say you talk about a motor, right? For example, a motor will tell you that it's breaking down maybe when it starts to heat up, right? You start to see a lot of heating. Or maybe it starts to give a lot of noise, right? For example, if let's say your car starts to break down, you give a lot of grr, grr, grr kind of noise. Machines are the same, right? But you don't want to reach a point where when you start to see smoke, then you know that your machine is going to break down any minute, right? You want to be able to have some time, right, to actually mitigate your machine from reaching its functional failure. Therefore, you will utilize other techniques such as, you know, vibration, ultrasound, or many other kinds of techniques or power monitoring to then identify issues at an early start before it actually starts to break down, right? So this will actually help to keep your machines running at optimum level. So the whole idea is utilizing data, right, or machine data, similar to how, you know, we run diagnostic analysis of human bodies, right? We do the same for machines as well. What we do is we put in sensors on the machines, right, to do what we call as condition monitoring. And once we actually look at condition monitoring, when we continuously check the condition of the equipment over time, we are actually able to identify the rate of degradation over time, right? And once we identify that, we know when it will actually fail functionally, the point that you will fail functionally. So the next step of it is actually to predict when it will actually start to fail, right? Or start to give some signals of the machine failing. And therefore, we are able to put in the right mitigation steps to lengthen the P to F interval so that we have sufficient time to maintain it until it reaches its functional failure. So it's moving from the point of reactive maintenance. Reactive maintenance is when, you know, your machine hits functional failure, when it starts to smoke, right? Therefore, you know that, okay, I need to go and fix it now, right? So then we move to preventive maintenance, where preventive means that you have scheduled downtime, scheduled maintenance strategies, right? So you maintain it regularly so that you wouldn't break. So a similar example is like your car, right? You have scheduled maintenance for your car. If you actually go beyond that scheduled maintenance, potentially your car may have future issues that we are not aware of, right? So then we talk about predictive, right? Predictive is basically using data, right? Data that you collect from the condition monitoring to actually do health diagnostics of your machine and therefore identifying when is a point that they will start to fail, right? And prescriptive, of course, that will go into a bit more beyond where the machine will actually be able to utilize AI methodologies, right? To actually prescribe to you what is the potential, analysis and actions that can be taken to solve your issue, right? So therefore, we talk about the four types of data analytics, right? The first step is always descriptive, basically what is happening. Diagnostic, why is it happening? Predictive, what is likely to happen? And prescriptive is what do I need to do, right? By all means of all different data analytics strategies or types of data analytics, as the complexity increases, the value also increases, right? Because once you reach a certain level of, you know, prescriptive capabilities, it will definitely give you a lot of value to your business operations. But of course, it's also a bit more complex to implement, right? It requires a lot of data. It requires a lot of strategy in terms of collecting the data and then utilizing that data to make the right decisions for you, right? So how does data analytics or, you know, how does data automation help you to actually provide you with useful information to actually optimize your machine utilization? So if you think about Google Translate, right, when we speak in this webinar in English, and if you want to translate it, you know, to let's say Spanish or any other languages, right, you can do that through Google Translate. Now, the same thing for machines. What we are trying to do is to get the machines to tell us a story, right, to tell us what is actually happening to them, right? So sensors are placed into the machines for them to tell us what is their current status, what is going to happen, and what is actually happening in the machine. So let's say if we look at this Google Translate over here, it's translating a machine signal where it is telling you what is happening, where he's telling you that the machine has a problem, anomaly is detected. Why is it happening? Basically, the motor has some faults. And what is likely to happen? The machine will shut down in 15 minutes because there is motor faults, right? So therefore, basically, you are already translating what the machine is trying to tell you through the signals that you are collecting. So this is basically how data analytics is used to actually optimize your machine utilization. Now, the simple way of doing descriptive analytics is basically trying to source out what is happening, right? And to get that, basically, you can use real-time OEE calculation, where you can look at the overall availability, performance, and the quality, right? And straight away, by doing OEE calculation, you can already identify why is it happening, you know, by identifying the root causes, you know, which causes your losses, right? Your six big losses. So why is it happening when you have a lot of breakdowns? Why is it happening when you have a lot of minor stoppages, your speed is not at its optimum level, and why you have a lot of startup losses? So asking a lot of questions on why, you know, once you identify the six big losses, you're actually able to drill down to the root cause of what's actually happening to your machine, right? Or your manufacturing operation by using diagnostic analysis. And then of course, once you have a lot of data running in your machine, right, you're able to look at your machine running over a long period of time, then of course now you can now start to look at, you know, what is likely to happen by using data to forecast what is going to happen in the next, you know, what happened in the next half an hour or the next 1 hour. So you're then able to identify, okay, right, something is wrong with my machine, because you start to see some error deviation over here, right, because your forecaster is supposed to look good, but suddenly you start to have some deviation in your data set. So from here, you're actually able to straight away identify that, okay, my machine is having a problem. I need to start looking into it now, right? So this is actually how you can utilize data to do anomaly detection, right? Because when you buy a machine, you will never expect the machine to fail immediately, right? So of course, your prediction of your machine health would always be good over time, right? But over the period of time, you start to see your motor position is deviating, your torque is deviating, your power consumption is deviating, or something is happening in your machine. So therefore, you want to utilize that kind of forecasting data to actually look at the error, you know, the amount of error that is estimated, right? And therefore, you're able to detect an anomaly from happening. So this is how you utilize data-driven strategies to actually look into your machine health, and therefore optimize your machine utilization. So the five criteria of importance for quantity and quality of data is really looking at the volume, right? The V for volume, the size of your data set. It shouldn't be that you just collect data for one day and then you can say that, okay, I know everything about my operation. My machine can now do prediction for the rest of the year, right? It's not necessary like that, because every machine has its own trend, has its own behavior, and therefore having more volume of data will only help you to improve the accuracy of your prediction, right? And velocity. Now, if your machine is operating at 5 seconds per at 5 seconds, right? Every operation is 5 seconds, and if you collect your data every 10 seconds, you're actually sampling your data at the wrong sample rate, right? So velocity actually tells you what is your sample rate, right? And therefore, if it's running at 5 seconds per part, therefore you actually need to sample at a shorter time sampling rate, maybe every second, right? To get the valuable data for you. Now, variety basically looks at a variety of data set. Now, if you only analyze only one set of data, one type of data, which is the variety, you may not be able to see the bigger picture, right? If you have more information, more variety of data sets, you actually get more flavor in your data. And therefore, you actually are able to make accurate decisions and predictions, right? Data accuracy, which is also called veracity, is also important, right? You need to ensure that your data is accurately measured, right? Let's say temperature. If you are supposed to measure at 37 degrees Celsius, but your temperature sensor that you put in is measuring at 30. So that offset is already very, very big, right? So you need to always ensure that there is some level of accuracy. And of course, the last part will be the value of your data. Collect data that is valuable to you and therefore useful for your insight, right, and your decision-making. So machine health monitoring can always help in terms of keeping your machines at optimum level, because you're able to look at your machines, to be able to identify issues at early stage, reduce your overall unscheduled downtime, right? Provide real-time machine insights, right? Improve your machine utilization, reduction in maintenance costs, because you don't maintain your machine just when you start to see smoke happening, right? Which is a bigger issue, right? Improve your production output, and identify more data-driven root cause kind of analysis. So therefore, by looking at all this, you're actually able to keep your machines running at optimum level, right? And therefore reducing your overall cost of downtime or losses. So how do we then utilize some of the methodologies or strategies to do machine health monitoring? The first step is actually to look at, what kind of data that your machine is actually providing to you. Now, machines will give data in two forms. One is digital, one is analog signal, right? Digital signals are basically, on-off signals, zero or one, right? And analog signals basically will give you a variety of data sets. For example, a digital signal is like a proximity sensor, right? If there's a part or no part, it's either zero or one, right? Let's say temperature. Temperature is not like zero or 30 degrees, right? It has zero, one, two, three, all the way until 30 degrees. So that variation gives you your overall analog signal variation. And therefore, from there, you're actually able to identify more information of your machines. So once you look at these two data sets, the next step is how do we collect that data? So there are two types of methods that you can use to collect your data, right? You can look at using an IoT gateway, right? For example, like this, you can collect your digital input, you can collect your analog input using this kind of IoT gateway, different kind of signals. Now, there is also a technology called IO-Link, right? And IO-Link looks at smart sensor technologies, right? So you have digital or analog input that you can just plug inside this IoT, IO-Link hub here. And then straight away, you can measure your data and you can also actuate certain actuators, from here, like lights or cylinders, right? Based on the data that you collect. So this is a direct application of technology where this information about IO-Link technology can be shared more by Frederick later from Baluf, where you can see how this technology is utilized for the industry to collect many, many different types of data and to also look into condition monitoring. So for OEE, by collecting your digital signals, you can straight away calculate your overall equipment effectiveness, right? You can straight away look at, how is your availability from just your tower light signals. Performance, you can utilize sensors like input and output sensors to actually see your overall performance. Quality, you can utilize certain sensors or even push buttons to identify the quality issues. And straight away build a dashboard like this, which you can already start to see in real time what is actually happening to your machine. So it starts to give you your descriptive and diagnostic analytics already. Now, of course, over time, if you want to look at, condition monitoring, where you can put smart sensors like vibration sensors over here using IO-Link technologies. So this is actually running in our lab at the moment, where we connected the smart sensor to the motor. And once we visualize the data through a dashboard like this, once we turn on the motor, you can start to see that, the motor starts to emit certain vibration, certain temperature levels as it is moving. And here the motor, we purposely put it at an angle so that it shows that there's certain imbalance or vibration happening. And then straight away, if the motor is vibrating too much, it will start to trigger a warning signal on the dashboard like this. So by looking at this in real time, you are actually able to then identify, okay, there's something wrong with my motor, I should go and check it out, right? Especially when you look into conveyor systems or you look into pumps, right? If you put these kind of sensors, like vibration sensors, you're already able to gather a lot of insights on what's actually happening to your machine over time. So these are some of the technologies that you can use, right? And although we think that, okay, wow, it looks very complicated, it looks like it's not easy to implement, but what I would say is actually quite straightforward, right? All you need is basically a master hub, you need a sensor, and just connect it. Utilize, drag and drop tools such as like Node-RED to actually connect these sensors together, and straight away visualize your data straight in a dashboard like this. So this is actually a very, very straightforward application to really utilize the hardware and software integration, collect the data that you need, and you can straight away visualize this data over a period of time, right? You can actually start to see different kind of trends, right, from your motor, and start to see snapshots of data or behavior over time, and then start to make your own predictive analytics. So the first step is always on data collection, right? We talk about data generation as a level one. And then you look into visualization, like what you saw just now into your vibration data. Then you talk about storage, because when you want to do predictive analytics later on, you need to store your data, right? Without storing your data, it's very, very difficult to identify what is the trends, what is the data that you want to look at. And then formulate it, right? Look into what kind of data you're measuring. Formulate an equation of effectiveness, and then only look into analytics. So these are the five levels of data automation maturity that industries can look at to really, really get started, right? And of course, when you look into in deep down how this level looks like in terms of a shop floor topology, right? We start from level one at the bottom, collection of data, then level two and level three, store and visualize, level four to formulate, and then you look into level five when you look into data analytics. So all these level one to level five can be a step-by-step approach, right, towards machine health monitoring and improving your overall machine utilization. And of course, in SHRDC, what we do is we translate whatever that we develop into high impact training programs. Therefore, each level of the data automation maturity level are packaged into programs, right? So if you want to get started, you can start off at level one or even level 0.5. Right, level 0.5 is actually more for the management level and the overall level of engineering managers to look into what are the technologies there to support their industrial 4.0 applications. Then you look into more technical programs like level one for data generation, level two and three, which is machine data logging and visualization, level four, which is OEE, and then level five, which is data analytics. So the whole idea about focusing on open collaborative platforms is to ensure open and scalable technologies, helping industries to start off at a lower upfront investment. And the idea of it is always readiness to replicate. So the maximum value creation that can happen for any industry, we believe, starts with digital transformation ownership, right? Sustainable technology integration, and therefore overall improvement in your ROI, right? So if you start with a very, very cost-effective step, you improve your overall ROI and you can see greater productivity over time. So essentially what we do at SHRDC under the Malaysian Smart Factory is that we focus on tech talent development. We also do technology learning platform where once this MCO period is lifted, we are more than happy to have you all at our site, right? To actually see the Smart Factory in real life, right? We do a lot of proof of concept and lighthouse projects. So industries that intend to look into digitizing certain operations, we are more than happy to look into your problem statements. Live demonstration of technologies where we showcase technologies happening in our center at the moment, right? Digital training platform, right? Right now with the pandemic situation, we have actually launched our remote online training, right? Therefore, at the comfort of your office or your home, you can actually conduct or do your training, just by logging into our equipments, do the hands-on training remotely, right? And still obtain the right skills and competencies to start your industry 4.0 journey. So with that, before I end my presentation, do get in touch with us. If you intend to talk to us more about your journey, right? We are more than happy to support you all the way. All right, so thank you very much. And here is a QR code for our virtual tour if you intend to have a look at the Smart Factory, and do get in touch with us in due time. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chua. It is indeed really insightful, actually. It is a lot of information to digest. But I think to maybe take a few notes out of it would be, let's hope we don't see the smoke coming out from the model. Then at least we know that our machine is actually running correctly. So I think this is where, let's hope you don't have too much unusual noise or too much unusual heat, which would create some smoke in the motor. So hopefully we don't get to that portion, and then we can actually maintain our motor at its optimum level. Thank you very much, Dr. Chua, again.